So good afternoon, everyone. So we will now examine the question of the relationship of medieval rural society to disease through a French case study. The case that will interest us comes from the churchyard of Notre-Dame de Rigny. This former parish is located in the région centre and more precisely in the department of Indre-et-Loire, 30 kilometers southwest of the city of Tours. This site is located at the bottom of a small valley that is perpendicular to the floodplain, 1.2 kilometers away from the Indre River and 2 kilometers away from the Loire River. The excavation around the church of Rigny was carried out under the supervision of Elisabeth Zadora Rio and Henri Galinier from 1986 to 1999. It has led to a better understanding of the formation process of a rural parish center, and it has also allowed the study of the population buried in the parish cemetery and the evolution of funeral practices from medieval to contemporary times. 1,738 graves have been excavated. They are dated from the middle of the 8th century to 1865, which is the year in which the parish center was transferred. The study of the parish registers for the period from 1670 to 1792 and of the civil registers from 1793 to 1856 show a mainly farming village, but also oriented toward craft and trade. Thus, 13% of the adult male population buried in Rigny, whose profession is well documented, is composed of merchants and only 8% of notables, against more than 40% of daily workers. Among the 1,738 burials excavated in the parish cemetery, the tomb of the individual 1,437 is that of a person buried between the 12th and the 5th century, probably in a burial shroud. His head held upright by two stones. This kind of arrangement to hold the deceased head is generally interpreted as a sign of deference to God, and in Rigny, this type of burial with cephalic arrangement is mainly used in the oldest burial phases, but it lasted longer during the Middle Ages. This individual was identified as a woman, at least 50 years old at the time of her death. Her appendicular skeleton, well represented, showed only lesions related to senescence as osteoarthritis, encephalopathy, or small snout. However, the skull of this individual has mandibulofacial dysostosis with bilateral and symmetrical hypoplasia of the zygomatic bones. The lower margin of the orbits are incomplete and infraorbital foramen are absent. The mandible, and more particularly its branches, are also hypoplastic. Its body has a concavity on the underside, and the gonial angles appear more open than normal. The condylar cervix is short, and temporal bones are also marked by the incomplete zygomatic arches and the atresia of the external acoustic meatus. These osteological features are characteristic of Treacher-Collins syndrome, a craniofacial congenital condition which is particularly rare in the contemporary population. To our knowledge, it is the first time that it is identified in the archaeological record. The Treacher-Collins syndrome is also known as Franceschetti's Valenclein syndrome or mandibulofacial dysostosis. It is an autosomal dominant disorder of craniofacial development. Nowadays, it occurs with a frequency of approximately 1 in 50,000 live births. Mutation in TCOF1 and in a smaller subset of Treacher-Collins syndrome patients in PLR1D and PLR1C are held responsible for the resulting phenotype. Nevertheless, in some Treacher-Collins syndrome patients, no mutation within the three genes are detected. The condition is autosomal dominant disorder with a variable degree of penetrance and expressions. Between 50% and 60% of cases have no family history and are mutation de novo. So far, over 120 mutations have been identified. However, combined analysis of these variant and clinical features has not demonstrated a clear relationship between genotype and phenotype. There is no gender predilection, and mutations can be spliced, nonsense, or deletions variants. Craniofacial deformities consist mostly of defects in the periorbital regions and hypoplasia of the mandible and zygoma, microcia and middle ear deformities. The range of presentation is wide, from mild case with no functional deficits and minimal deformity to severe case in which death may occur in the perinatal period as a result of airway compromise. The facial appearance is characteristic. Abnormalities are bilateral and usually symmetric, but not always. The hypoplastic malar bones make the nose appear more prominent and the nasal root width is increased, but the nose is usually of normal size and the face is narrow. Downward sloping palpebral fissures, depressed cheekbones, malformed pinnae, receding chin, and large dental mouth are characteristic. The facial profile in TCS is dramatically convex due to the pronounced retrognathia. Patients have no associated developmental delay or neurological disorders, but often face social challenges through life because of the physical appearance. Bilateral conductive deafness is common in mandibulofacial dysostosis with or without atresia of the external auditory meatus. This deafness is due to a wide range of deformity of the ossicular chain associated with a characteristic reduction in the size of the middle ear cavity. The inner ear is essentially normal. In the case of this individual, in addition to the consequences of this syndrome in the individual's physical appearance, repercussion on his hearing could be suspected. Therefore, an analysis of his hearing system was conducted by CTscan.
The skull was acquired by CTScan at the tier platform of the Indre-et-Loire. In order to facilitate the three-dimensional comprehension of the internal anatomy, a protocol of segmentation and 3D reconstruction was implemented using the TIGMIS software. Segmentation is the operation consisting of selecting on the slices the tissues of interest, and it is particularly useful for the visualization of cavities, as illustrated on this example of an endocast. For the case studied, the ear is a focus area. The internal ear can be easily studied by CT scan as shown on the slide. It is composed of the external acoustic meatus separated from the tympanic cavity by the tympanic membrane. The cavity contains the ossicles and the stapes is connected to the osseous labyrinth by the oval window. When a sound wave penetrates the external acoustic meatus, the tympanic membrane vibrates and puts the ossicles in motion. This motion is transmitted to the cochlea by the stapes at the oval window. On this referential, obtained from a subject buried in a parish cemetery from Touraine, we can see the internal ear here, and also the external acoustic meatus and the tympanic cavity, and they are connected because the tympanous membrane disappeared during the decomposition. And now, if we look at the case of Treacher-Collins, we can see the osseous labyrinth here, which is normal, but the external meatus is not connected to the cochlea and present a severe atrophy. It has a diameter of 1 millimeter, whereas on the referential, we are about around 1 centimeter. Thus, the subject presents a severe hypoplasia of the middle ear associated with the absence of the tympanic cavity and the lack of the oval window. The rest of the cochlea and semicircular canals are normal. The dysplasia can be part of the Treacher-Collins syndrome. This syndrome can include an hypoplastic middle ear, but the osseous labyrinth is normal. Other observations led to a diagnostic of bilateral congenital conductive deafness. Deafness in medieval society is recognized as a disease, as shown on this illustration from the treatise Arte de Physicalia de Chirurgia by John Arden, an English surgeon from the 14th century. And as a disease, it can be treated by medication. Deafness is also recognized as a source for mutism, as explained in the treatise Dialogue between a Lord and a Clerk by John Trevisa. And I quote, "Since the time that the Tower of Babel was built, men have spoken with diverse tongues in such a way that diverse men be alien to another and do not understand other speech. Common learning of speech is by hearing, so always he who is deaf is always mute, for he cannot hear speech to learn." A more personal take on deafness is given by the writings of Teresa de Cartagena, a medieval nun who suffered from progressive deafness. And I quote, "When I look at my suffering in worldly terms, it seems very painful and anguished. But when I turn my thought from these concerns, drawing it into my breast, and I see the solitude that my suffering imposes, separating me from worldly transactions, I call it a kind of solitude, a blessed solitude, a solitude that isolates me from dangerous things and surrounds me with sure blessings, a solitude that removes me from things harmful and dangerous to my body and soul." So the first part of this excerpt enlightens the social and psychological burden associated to deafness, but with the association of deafness with isolation, anguish, and pain. But the second part is about the acceptance of this impairment and its benefit in a religious life. In fact, religious institutions seem more able to integrate deaf people in their communities. They see the development of sign languages and lectures for the deaf during the 16th and 17th century. For the rural context, we do not have texts about the perception of deafness, but it is likely that communication impediment may have had an impact on the integration in the community.
In the medieval period, food was a powerful marker of social identity. It also actively contributes to the health of individuals, according to Hippocrates' theory of humors, because it helps to maintain a balanced mood. This argument motivated the integration of 48 individuals from Rigny, including the individual with Treacher-Collins syndrome, into the study of diet of medieval populations in Swan. This ongoing study, a part of my thesis, aimed at the comparison of the diet of 6 populations, including 5 from the city of Tours and its surrounding. The isotopic ratios of human collagen are compared to several types of animal protein, aquatic and terrestrial food environment, potentially consumed based on archaeological data. Food isotopic variability was estimated from 98 medieval animals from Tours, Maillet, and Chambord sites. These animals come from both aquatic and terrestrial environments. They are divided into 8 groups based on environmental, biological, and domestication criteria. Among the aquatic group, the first is composed of freshwater animals, the second of anadromous and catadromous species, and the third of marine animals. Among the terrestrial group, the first is composed of wild herbivores, the second of domestic herbivores, the third of domestic omnivores, the fourth of carnivore and human commensals, and the last of migratory birds. The isotopic signatures of these different groups are quite distinct. When a heavy carbon enrichment of 1 per mil and 1 of 4 per mil of heavy nitrogen is applied to this different group, the expected range of value are obtained for a theoretical exclusive consumption of this resource of this group. When we compare this range of value with the isotopic ratios of carbon and nitrogen in human in Rigny and the different seeds in Tours, we see a difference in the resource consumed between the city and the countryside. The city populations have a diet based mainly on meat from domestic omnivores, pigs and poultry, with a variable proportion of aquatic resources, probably freshwater. The population of the Rigny community has a diet based mainly on meat from domestic herbivores, bovine and caprine, with a variable proportion of aquatic resources, probably freshwater. The individual with Treacher-Collins syndrome has a central isotopic signature within Rigny isotope variability. Thus, no change in the diet of this individual compared to the rest of the community is perceptible. This result does not argue in favor of a food arrangement in a care perspective, but it is no more consistent with an individual excluded from his community. The similarity of eating behaviors and integration into the community of the faithful through the funeral practices from which this individual benefited, as well as his age at death and the absence of any signs of mistreatment, are consistent with a form of care by the community for this individual with an atypical face and suffering from deafness and therefore probably mutism. This case, in addition to the fact that it is the first to be described in the archaeological registers of this type of pathology, also raises the question of her archaeological perception of care in a rural context.
As Anna Tilly noticed in the publication of her thesis, there are 2 intuitive ways to approach care in archaeological record. First of all, by stigmata of care, like surgery, and we will see some examples in the next presentation. And when a subject presents a disability incompatible with its survival without care. For the case presented, this woman suffered from a physical dysplasia, deafness, and mutism. This paleopathological condition must have an impact on the subject's social integration and psychological state. The rest of her skeleton does not show signs of abuses, and both the isotopic analysis and funerary practices lead to an integration in the community of the living and the dead. All the signs support the hypothesis that the social stigmata of the Treacher-Collins syndrome were counterbalanced by a benevolent attitude of contemporaries. Despite the lack of direct evidence of care, we can assume that in this rural community, this subject received a form of care. Thank you for your attention.